Hey, everybody. Thanks for joining me. I think you all have the announcement from the EPA. Let me make some comments on that announcement. Abandoned hard rock mines are a serious problem facing the West, and a problem so large that the federal government welcomes the help of private individuals and groups who are called Good Samaritans who want to help. However, one of the biggest issues giving Good Samaritans pause has been the issue of liability once they start to work on a site. And I've championed the effort to provide Good Samaritans with liability protection so they can get back to work cleaning up these toxic mines.
There are Good Samaritan issues all across the United States. In the eastern and central parts of the United States, the main issue is inactive coal mines that are draining toxic water into the stream systems. The different geology in the Rocky Mountain West drew hard rock miners searching for gold and silver. Hard rock mines are more of an issue in the West. Overall, there are about 500,000 abandoned mines in the United States. River basins throughout the U.S. would benefit from Good Samaritan liability protection. Colorado has been a leader in proposing legislation because there is a lot of interest in cleaning up abandoned mines in the state. For illustrative purposes, let's focus on the southwest corner of Colorado. Favorable geology has been the driver for mining. Here is an image of the Colorado Plateau. Around the edges of the plateau are volcanic formations, seen here in orange. A closer look shows the San Juan volcanic field in southwest Colorado. Precious metals and other minerals are at the surface or closer to the surface in these volcanic fields. In the middle of the San Juan field is the Silverton Caldera, a collapsed volcano. Watershed groups are actively cleaning up some of the abandoned mines in the area and would benefit from Good Samaritan liability protection. They include the Uncompahgre Watershed Partnership in Ridgeway, working to remove toxic metals entering the Uncompahgre River on the north side of the caldera, and the Animas River Stakeholders Group in Silverton, working on abandoned mines inside the caldera, trying to remove toxic metals entering the Animas River that flows south. Miners came, and the big boom years were generally from 1878 to 1907 in places like Leadville, Creed, Aspen, Ouray, Silverton, Durango, and Telluride. Today, many of the historic mining districts are now tourism and recreation centers, with downhill skiing as a big draw. The legacy remains as the mining activities from over 100 years ago are contaminating our watersheds.
Now, the problems that are caused by abandoned and inactive mines are very real and very large. They include acidic water draining from old tunnels, heavy metals leaching into streams, killing fish and tainting water supplies, open vertical mine shafts, dangerous high walls, large open pits, waste rock piles that are unsightly and dangerous, and hazardous dilapidated structures. Now, Madam President, unfortunately, many of our current environmental laws designed to mitigate the impact from operating hard rock mines are of limited effectiveness when they're applied to abandoned and inactive mines. So as a result, many of these old mines go on polluting streams and rivers and potentially risking the health of people who live nearby or downstream.
Multiple toxic small drainages that have a high concentration of dissolved metals are contaminating the rivers of the Southwest. In Creed, Willow Creek feeds into the headwaters of the Rio Grande River. The Cement Creek area near Silverton feeds into the Animas River. Near Ouray, Red Mountain Creek feeds into the Uncompahgre River. And many of these areas eventually feed into the Colorado River.
Okay, so Emily and I are at a confluence of Red Mound Creek, which is this orange-colored creek, and a confluence with a stream that's draining a pretty clear wetland here in Ironton Park. And we just sampled that cleaner-looking water upstream, and what we found is that the pH there is near neutral, about 6.5, 7 or so. So suggesting there's probably not a whole lot of heavy metal loading. Right now, Emily's taking a sample of the Red Mountain Creek water, and we're going to find out what the pH is in there. So generally, reddish color suggests maybe 3 or 4. So we'll see what she finds.
It's like a reddish.
So that's indicating to us that the pH is about 3, 4 or so. We don't have the probe with us today, so it's not a very accurate test, but a pH of 3 or 4 means that the waters in this creek, in Red Mountain Creek, are pretty acidic. And actually, based on what we know, is that around a pH of 3, 3.2, heavy metals that are in solution from draining mines start precipitating at that slightly higher pH. So that's why we're seeing all this iron precipitate that's in the stream water, but it's also settling out here on the rocks.
Now, while the Clean Water Act is one of the most effective and important of our environmental laws, as applied to abandoned hard rock mines, it can mean that someone undertaking to clean up an abandoned or inactive mine will be exposed to the same liability that would apply to a party responsible for creating the site's problems in the first place. As a result, would-be Good Samaritans understandably have been unwilling to volunteer their services to clean up abandoned and inactive mines.
Without the needed Clean Water Act liability protection, good opportunities are being missed and polluted water continues to degrade our streams and rivers. For example, the Tiger Mine Restoration Project near Leadville, Colorado, a proposed project in the headwaters of the Lake Fork of the Arkansas River, is on hold, and Colorado's Upper Animas River Stakeholders Group, which has been very successful in improving water quality over the past two decades, is now losing ground in its fight against abandoned mine pollution in the Animas because the necessary restoration projects are held up by Clean Water Act liability concerns.
It's well intended to make companies liable, but if it's infinite liability forever, and no one can touch that land even to do some good, it has the perverse result of preventing anyone helping at all on some of these places.
In terms of liability when cleaning up inactive hard rock mines, there are two main categories. Solid mine waste in the form of piles of waste rock or tailings can be transported into the stream system either by rain or snow runoff, snow avalanches, or by the stream channel itself. This is called non-point source pollution. Good Samaritans can remove or relocate the mine waste or divert water away from the mine waste with little or no liability. Another method is to divert water away from the mine workings. In this example, the water is being kept from entering the mine as the openings to the mine workings have been covered over. Less water seeps through the mineralized parts of the mine which contain metals, and less acid water drains from the mine. The issue of liability for Good Samaritans comes from the toxic water that drains from the mines into the streams and rivers downstream. This type of pollution is called point source pollution. Section 402 of the Clean Water Act requires a discharge permit for point sources of pollution under the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, or an NPDES permit, just like a municipal wastewater treatment system would have in your local town. As we look at the volcanic caldera again, we see that Red Mountain is a natural producer of acid sulfate. While there is pre-existing natural metal loading, there are also many draining mines that add additional metals and acids into the stream system.
This one looks really, pretty striking.
Yeah. It is. It's, like I said, this is the poster child. And really, like I said, this is a pretty big site for any Good Samaritan to take on. But, you know, a mining company that had some, wanted to trade off some liabilities or something, they might be willing to do something with this. They'd certainly provide a lot more options to deal with it, mm-hmm. with a Good Samaritan provision. So this is the drainage coming out of the Anglo-Saxon mine, and it's got a fairly high level of cadmium, zinc, copper, iron in it. That's a collapsed mine. The portal's all smashed in, collapsed. It's probably about 15-20 gallons per minute. And this is one of our priority sites. We'd like to do something, some type of remediation on this site. You'd like a wetland. There's behind you there, there's enough space for a potential enhanced wetland. There's already a natural wetland there. So this is one that maybe some passive drainage could be done on. Technically, this site should have a discharge permit. And if anyone were to do some kind of remediation on this particular site, they have a liability that they might have to get a discharge permit if somebody forced them to do so. So as a result, even though this is one of our priority sites, we're not willing to touch this site until we can figure out the liability issue.